Good evening, my dear church. Greetings to one and all in the most holy and matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Yes, indeed, it is a great joy and privilege for us as Christians to be able to join together in this online manner in order to meditate upon God's Word. At the very outset, I am utterly thankful and grateful to God Almighty, for in my life, He chose me, He separated me for His full-time ministry, and He gave me this wonderful opportunity to share from His Word to His people. Since the whole past week, we have been meditating upon the series of Christian Life Fighting Temptations. On the first day, we focused on the temptation of Adam and Eve, thinking particularly about the nature of sin, the nature of idolatry, and its effects on us. And then on the second day, we meditated upon the temptation of Joseph, focusing especially on the sexual sin. Third day, we meditated upon the temptation of Hezekiah. That is a kind of deep-seated inconsistency, even in a man who in many ways is faithful servant of the Lord, bound up with arrogance and short-term thinking and his own comforts. Yesterday, we saw about the temptations of Jesus Christ. We saw that the Satan does not even bear Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He tempts him as well to break the first commandment, that is to love our God with all our minds, hearts, soul, and strength. And in likewise, in that mannerism, we could have focused on many other persons. We could have meditated upon the temptation of Jeremiah, in which the tendency towards self-pity and whining is focused. We could have focused on the temptation of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the kind of temptation they faced, and they faced it with the remarkable courage we can see. But in fact, this evening, this last day of this series, I would like to focus on the temptation of Peter. And to begin with, we will read Galatians chapter 2, verses beginning from 1 to 21. Galatians chapter 2, verses beginning from 11 to 21. The word of God says here, "But when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he was eating with Gentiles. But when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party. And the rest of the Jews acted hypocritically along with him, so that even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas before them all, 'If you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you force the Gentiles to live like Jews? We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ.'" So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of law, because by the works of the law, no one will be justified. But if, in our endeavor to be justified in Christ, we too were found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. For if I rebuild what I tore down, I prove myself to be a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose." Now, before plunging into this passage, I would like to take a few moments to direct your attention to two earlier episodes in Peter's life. Episodes that are revealing and prepare the way for this particular passage. The first is a well-known episode in Caesarea Philippi. In Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 following, we read, "Now then Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi. He asked the disciples, 'Who do people say the Son of Man is?' And they said, 'Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets.' He said to them, 'But who do you say that I am?' Simon Peter replies, Over here, the same Simon Peter is mentioned. Simon Peter replies, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly charged the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. From that time onwards, Jesus began to show these disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan, you are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Now, how could one man, in just a course of few verses, give a spectacular confession which Jesus himself acknowledges is the result of revelation from God, and on the other hand, earn Christ's rebuke, "Get behind me, Satan"? How could one man say something so truthful, "You are the Messiah," and then on the other hand say, "But quite frankly, Jesus, Messiah, you have got your theology wrong. Let me correct you. What you are saying is not the truth. The truth is that Messiahs don't die, they win." How does this happen in the life of Peter? Oh, we could look at a certain amount of arrogance that has to be involved over here. Peter is tempted to display arrogant behavior. Undoubtedly, that's true. We could also criticize his lack of self-knowledge. He has an overconfidence in his own spiritual maturity. You really ought to have an overconfidence in your own spiritual maturity to tell Jesus that he is wrong. But the particulars that I want to focus on are not those elements. Rather, underlying Peter's temptation to act so sinfully as to rebuke Jesus, underlying it is false theology. Do you see? Peter believes that Jesus is the Messiah. Peter believes that Jesus is the Christ. But when Peter says that, he does not mean exactly what you and I mean. When we confess that Jesus is the Christ, Jesus is the Messiah, we automatically integrate into our thinking that he is the Messiah who came and lived, that he is the incarnate Son of God who died on the cross, rose again on the third day, ascended on the right hand of the Majesty on high, sits there in as God's mediatorial King. We can't separate these things out from what we mean when we say Jesus is the Messiah. We live this side of the cross and resurrection. But at this point in his life, Peter doesn't have that integrated. He thinks that Messiahs don't die, they win. Especially a Messiah like Jesus, the Davidic King, the promised anointed one, but with spectacular powers. He can heal the sick, he can raise the dead, he can walk on water, he can feed thousands. What are you going to set up against with him, with all these miracle powers? Do you really think Herod's troops are going to control him, or even Rome's legions? How could you possibly imagine that he's going to die? For this juncture, Peter still does not have a grasp that this messianic figure is also the suffering servant. He just doesn't have it. He just doesn't get it. And when Jesus introduces the first five blocks of material in verses 21 and following, here in Matthew's Gospel, that insists that he must go, Messiah must go and die, it is so far outside Peter's theological understanding that he actually rebukes Jesus and says, "Never, Lord, this will never happen to you." And in one sense, Peter is even acting with what he thinks out of good motives. He's not saying that I'm going to take over this group. Jesus is out, I'm going to be the new group leader. He's not thinking along those lines. He doesn't have any evil intent in his mind. He is thinking that he is going to protect Jesus. Maybe Jesus is feeling a bit discouraged. He is talking about death and everybody knows that he cannot die. I mean, good grief. This miraculous powers. He is the promised messianic king. And he's just blessed me for having an insight that he is the messianic king. So let me help him along in this time of discouragement. Peter is thinking that. He's even got good motives, but he still earns a rebuke from Jesus. Get behind me, Satan. You don't understand the things of God. Why? Because he has false theology. He's got an element of truth, but not the balance of the truth. He does know that Jesus is the Messiah, but he doesn't know that Messiah is also the suffering servant. The largest proof that this is the case takes place in course when Jesus is actually dead and buried in the tomb. What are the apostles doing? Are they waiting in that upper room thinking, oh my God, we just cannot wait for Sunday when Jesus will be raised again? No. They are hiding themselves up in the upper room, thinking, being afraid of the Jewish leaders and the Roman government, that who is going to be arrested next, who is going to be persecuted. They are afraid. They still don't have a category for a crucified and resurrected Messiah. And undoubtedly, when Jesus kept talking about these things 5 times in the gospel, large block of material where Jesus talks about his impending death, undoubtedly they are saying, deep, deep. Jesus says a lot of deep things which we don't understand. What he is saying them sometimes, dig deep. We will surely understand sometime. We are not going to tell Jesus he is wrong again, because I know what happened to Peter the last time. So the disciples are just thinking, deep. Jesus is telling something very deep. And we will understand someday in future. But they don't understand it. They haven't got their Bible together. In Luke chapter 24, Jesus finally rebukes them after the resurrection and says, O fools and slow of heart to believe all the scriptures written. They just don't have their theology together yet. They don't know the Bible well enough. They don't know God well enough. So that even when they are confessing true things like Jesus is the Messiah, they still don't have the full picture of what Messiah has come to do. So here is a temptation to act sinfully, horribly sinfully, rebuking Jesus, no less, on the basis of false theology. Now, the second episode of Peter's life you find in Matthew chapter 26. You find in several other passages as well, but we will look at this one and begin especially at verses 33 and 34. Understand this context. Jesus has just insisted that on the night that he is betrayed, all will fall away on account of him. And Jesus even quotes Old Testament scripture in order to prove this point in verses 31 and 32. Then Peter replies in verse 33. Peter answered him, though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away. Jesus said to him, truly I tell to you, this very night before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Then in verse 69 we read, now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard and a servant girl came up to him and said, you are also with Jesus the Galilean. But he denied it before them saying, I do not know what you mean. And then when he went out to the entrance, another servant girl saw him and she said to the bystanders, this man was with Jesus of Nazareth. And again he denied it with an oath, I do not know the man. After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, certainly you too were one of them, for your accent betrays you. Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, I do not know him. And immediately the rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the words Jesus had spoken. Before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. And then he went outside and wept bitterly. Now, how did Peter allow himself to get into this mess? You see in verses 33 and 34 when he says, though everybody falls away from you, yet not I, he really has the best motives at heart. Although in fact he is contradicting Jesus. Jesus has just said that you all are going to run away from me, fall away on account of me. And Peter is saying, oh no, I am not. He says, he's so contradicting Jesus again. Jesus actually not only said this on the basis of his own authority, he even cited scripture as well to authorize his words. Peter is still contradicting Jesus. Now from his own point of view, he has got good motives. He says, if others betray you, if others fall away, maybe you are going to come up with some crisis experience in your life. It is going to be a touch and go thing. And many people will fall away. But I am going to be with you, Jesus. I know that you will win. You are the Messiah. He has still got the false theology. You see, he might have good motives, but he is acting horribly rebuking Jesus. Again, interpreting things the way he wants to interpret them. Still not understanding that the Messiah must die. And he ends up in woes and curses, denying Jesus repeatedly to serve a heresy. In other words, at the basis of this God-honoring sinfulness is false theology. Now, let us come back to the passage that we are focusing this evening. Galatians chapter 2, verses especially from 11 to 14. Verses 11 to 14. Galatians 2, 11 to 14. We must remember where we are now in the book of Acts. Paul is writing and he has been working for some time with Barnabas in the city of Antioch. And Antioch is a city with a remarkably mixed church, Jews and Gentiles alike. But this is taking place after an event that Peter himself has experienced, reported for us in Acts chapter 10 and 11. In Acts chapter 10 and 11, if you recall, Cornelius is visited by an angel from God, told to go and fetch a man called Peter. But Cornelius is a Gentile. He is not a kosher in any sense. Peter, meanwhile, was having a snooze up on the rooftop, and God sends him a remarkable dream of a sheet with all kinds of unclean food coming down, and the voice from heaven says, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." And then in his dream he says, "Absolutely no way, no bit of non-kosher food has ever touched my lips." Three times this comes, and each time the voice says something like this: "What God has made clean, let you not declare unclean." And then the knock on the door came from Cornelius, his servants. And so all of this develops into conversion of Gentiles. Peter ends up at Cornelius' house. And there's a friendship and fellowship. And then when he gets back to Jerusalem church in Acts chapter 11, they are a bit upset with what Peter have done. That this Peter is no longer acting like a decent, self-respecting Jew, eating only kosher food. But in fact, Peter goes through the whole thing and explains what happened. And shows that God had revealed this remarkable vision of sheep and the unclean animals. And tells how the Holy Spirit fell on Gentiles when he preached to them. And so the whole church comes to a conclusion. Well then, grace has come to the Gentiles also. Clearly, they don't have to eat kosher food in order to accept Jesus. In other words, of course the kosher food laws, it cannot be so binding after all. And undoubtedly, they also remembered the words that Jesus had spoken in Mark chapter 7. He said certain things about food, and Mark writes, "This he said, making all food clean." So what they are doing here? They were getting a bit more of their theology together that has already taken place before this event. So what is going on here? Now how you understand what is going on here in Galatians chapter 2 really depends pretty strongly on how you understand what a couple of phrases in verse 12 mean. Begin at verse 11. Here the word of God says, "But when Cephas came to Antioch." Okay, this is the home patch for Barnabas and Paul. Cephas is not normally over here, but Cephas, Peter, is now here visiting the church in Antioch. This mixed-race church. Paul writes, "I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned." That is, from Paul's point of view, he was acting like a guilty sinner and was condemned. Now, what was it that condemned him from Paul's perspective? Over here it is written, "For before a certain man came from James, he was eating with Gentiles. But when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party." Now, over here, the certain men from James, here the James is the half-brother of Christ, who by this time is the senior leader, an elder, senior pastor of the church in Jerusalem. So these brothers have come from Jerusalem church. Undoubtedly, they are conservative Jewish Christians. They have come from James. So before certain men came from James, they came from James to Antioch. Peter used to eat with Gentiles. In other words, Christians sometimes met together for meals, not only for Lord's Supper, but they had entire meals together. And because Peter has already gone through the experience of Acts 10 and Acts 11, the sheet dropped down from heaven, he's got used to the idea now of Gentiles becoming Christians, and though they don't follow the food, kosher food laws, he is now okay with the idea of eating and fellowshipping with them, with the Gentiles. Peter, in the church in Antioch, he mixes with all Christians just like everybody else, Jews and Gentiles, it doesn't matter. If they have pork chops for lunch, well then he'll eat pork as well. It's a remarkable thing. He's a Jew and he likes the bacon sandwiches now. It's a remarkable thing because the rest of the Christians are eating them and he is eating them too. Do you see? He's set free from his conservative mindset. But before, the men came from James, he used to eat with Gentiles, but when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of the circumcision party. In other words, it looks as if when the meals were broken out, then from these people, from James, they wanted a separate table with the kosher food over in the corner somewhere. So the Christians of the city of Antioch accommodated them a separate table with the kosher food. The impression given here is that Peter begins to draw back. That is, he eats with Gentiles mostly over here. But when these people from James came, he has one meal with them, which is okay. But then he has another meal with them, and then more meals with them, then with them. And pretty soon, all of his meals are over there with the people who came from James, and other Jewish Christians are looking around and starting to think, Peter does that, so maybe we should also do that too. Maybe that's the way to go. And so other Jewish Christians also start joining that table pretty soon, and they have got all the tables except for the Gentile tables over here. And we are told that even Barnabas was led astray. Barnabas, who is known for his encouraging demeanor, who was sent by the apostle to this church precisely because he could bring some healing to a mixed group. Do you see? Now the question is, why did Peter act in that way? The text says in verse 12, he did that fearing the circumcision party. He was afraid of those who belong to the circumcision group. The question is then, who are the circumcision group and what is Peter afraid of? Now, there are really two ways of answering this. The first one is common, but I think that is mistaken. The first way suggests that the circumcision group, that expression, refers to the same people who came from James to Antioch. So over here, the people who have come from James are having a separate table with best kosher food possible, and Peter is afraid of them. The circumcision group, that is, he's afraid of what they will think. Maybe they'll begin to look down at Peter. They'll become self-conscious about Peter. Peter thinks, oh boy, I don't want them to think too bad of me. So he's afraid of what they think. He's got the fear of men in him. And so he moves across to the other tables. That's the way it's often understood. In other words, the circumcision group, that expression, refers to the same people who came from James. That is the first understanding. But I believe that is mistaken. Commonly people think that. I find that reconstruction singularly implausible. After all, we have already seen that by this time they have lived through the experiences of Acts 10 and 11. Not only Peter has come to the grips with the vision of the sheet coming down from heaven, he has explained all this back to the church in Jerusalem as well. And the church in Jerusalem has agreed on to it. So those from James who have come to Antioch are already a part of this group that has accepted with eating kosher and non-kosher food. It's already been agreed that the Holy Spirit has fallen on Gentiles as well upon Jews. There is one church. God's grace has extended that far that the salvation achieved by Messiah extend not only to Jews but also to Gentiles. Those are the settled issues now. Moreover, to suggest that Peter is so flaky, so much of a coward, that he is scared of a few Jews from Jerusalem, think of it. Doesn't sound like Peter. Whatever else Peter is, he's not a person who will fear men. He's the Son of Man who can stand up on the day of Pentecost, empowered by the Spirit of God, to speak to the thousands and thousands. Do you see? He is bold. He is sometimes not sensible, but he is bold. He is courageous. He is not a coward. It just doesn't sound like him at all. But there is another way of understanding this passage, which in my view makes a lot more sense. Do you see the expression, the circumcision group may not refer to the same men who had come from James to Antioch. The expression, the circumcision group, is used in several different ways in the New Testament. For example, it may refer simply to the unconverted Jews, the circumcision group. That is the way it is used, for example, in Romans chapter 2. It can refer to the Jewish Christians who tend to be a little more conservative Christians, who still want to live under the law. And that is the way it is used, for example, in Acts chapter 10 verse 45. Thirdly, sometimes it can be used to refer to Jewish Christians as opposed to the Gentile Christians, without caring whether the Jewish Christians are conservative or not, keeping the law or not, keeping the food laws or not. They are Jewish Christians as opposed to the Gentile Christians. And that is the way it is used in Colossians chapter 4 verse 11. And fourthly, in one remarkable passage, it's actually used simply to refer to false teachers. We see this in Titus chapter 1 verse 10. So the question is, what does the circumcision group mean over here in our passage in Galatians chapter 2? If it is not referring to the men sent from James, then I suggest to you that this is referring to unconverted Jews. Now let me unpack this a little bit more. Go back to the beginning of verse 12. Over here it is written, for before a certain men came from James. Now that's interesting all by itself. Not before they came from Jerusalem, but from James. That makes it sound as if, you see, they were sent by James. They have got a message from James for Peter. Certain men sent from not just the church, but from James. James is actually wanting a message to be passed on to Peter. What the message was? Well, the text doesn't say. So you have to make a guess. But in this context, you can make a pretty good guess. Do you see, in this point of the life of the church in the first century, the church was undergoing quite a lot of persecution once again. The church had undergone persecution a decade earlier when Paul himself was persecuting them, when he was the arch persecutor of the church, going after all, throwing men and women into prison, killing some of them, going up to the Damascus city in order to capture more of them. You see, Paul himself knew about the persecution, but then it had died down a bit. And it was not too bad. And in the 40s, persecution came back, and the persecution was being offered not by the Roman legions, but it was being offered in Jerusalem by conservative Jews. And they were saying things like, yeah, you Christians, you are saying you are Jews and you are faithful to God and all of that, but you are not obeying the food laws. You see, you have now got a different view of the temple. You insist that this Jesus, who we condemned as a criminal, who was hanged on a tree and therefore cursed by God, he was damned man, and you are saying that he is the Messiah. You are a disgusting lot of people. You ought to be persecuted. You want to be suppressed. And not only so, but some of your own leaders. Or see, for example, your hero Peter. He is off there in Antioch eating non-kosher food. So James sends a message to Peter. My dear Peter, I am so glad to hear of the progress of the gospel in Antioch. Before I say what I want to say, I must reiterate that we are on the same page as to what gospel is. That point is made clear a little bit earlier in Galatians chapter 1. That Peter and Paul and James and so all, everyone in the room are on the same page to what the gospel is. We know that men and women are saved, Jews or Gentiles, by the blood of Christ. We know that that's the sole basis of their acceptance before God. We understand that. I'm not questioning that. But my dear Peter, we have got a situation here. Persecution has broken out a big time. And one of the things that our attackers are saying is that our leaders are constantly eating non-kosher food. They are not respecting their heritage. They are not obedient to the law. And that fires their animosity even more. Now I am not saying that you got to change your theology, Peter. But you need to remember your brothers and sisters in Christ down here in Jerusalem. Your actions mean that some people are going to jail. Your actions mean that some people are dying, being persecuted. Christians are getting killed. Be careful, Peter. Sincerely, your brother James. So when the text says that Peter began to act in this way for the fear of the circumcision group, what he actually is afraid of is the Jews that are back there in Jerusalem and that are persecuting the church. So from his point of view, once again, just like the different other two episodes that we saw in Matthew chapter 16 and 24, Peter is thinking that he is acting with good motives. Do you see? I am going to act in such a way that my brothers and sisters in Christ back in Jerusalem will be spared some persecution. You know, maybe if some story gets back and then some people say that when the Jews from church in Jerusalem went to Antioch, Peter almost had all their meals with them only. So let us persecute them less. That's what Peter is thinking. And after all, Barnabas likewise has friends back in Jerusalem and he wants to encourage those persecuted Christians because he is a son of encouragement. Until eventually, you have got a split church over here. In one corner, you have Peter and Barnabas and those from men from Jerusalem and then all the Jews in Antioch and maybe even some Gentiles who are thinking Jews are doing it, so we also should do it. This side is this group and on the other side, the rest of the Gentiles saying, you know, wait, I thought we are just justified by Jesus. We didn't know that we got to eat kosher food too. What's going on here? Are we the second class citizens? Are there two categories of Christians, Jewish Christians and everybody else? Are we the everybody else in the second tier Christians? And suddenly Paul can't stand it anymore. Undoubtedly, Paul has had some private conversations with Peter, but he didn't convince him. He didn't convince him at all. And now this has become so public that there is a split, there is a visible split in the church that is deep and fundamental, and it turns on fundamental issues of theology. So Paul says in verse 12, I opposed to him on his face because he was condemned. The other Jews joined him in this hypocrisy. What does he mean that this hypocrisy? Well, Peter is a hypocrite. He's play acting over here in that he had already eaten with Gentiles for so long time. He had defended that action even after the vision of sheet sent down from God to the Jerusalem church. The Jerusalem church understood that. So he was known for that. Now if he moves over here in this Jewish group just to avoid some persecution, that is play acting. It's not that he is really eating the kosher. It's not that he is really submitting the law of Moses all over again. It is just play acting. It's hypocrisy. And so we read in verse 14, but when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel. The conduct was not in line with the truth of the gospel. From Paul's perspective, what was at issue was the gospel truth. While Peter was thinking, how can I avoid acting in such a way that my brothers and sisters back in Jerusalem will be persecuted less, Paul is looking at the church in Antioch and saying, there are two fundamental theological issues at stake here, and both are bound up with the gospel. Firstly, the exclusive self-sufficiency of Jesus' death and resurrection as the basis for our acceptance before God. The exclusive self-sufficiency of Jesus' death and resurrection. Exclusive self-sufficiency. If Peter acts this way, he begins to send a signal saying, yeah, if you want to really, really on this side interact with God, it's Jesus plus eating kosher food. It's Jesus plus observing the food laws. It's Jesus plus getting circumcised. It's Jesus plus coming under the law of Moses again. And what you are fundamentally denying is the exclusive sufficiency of Christ. So actually you are saying something horribly false. Maybe unintentionally, but you are saying something horribly false about what Christ has achieved on the cross. And thus, it's the truth of the gospel that is being jeopardized. Second fundamental issue at hand here is, he says, what you are doing is splitting the church. The gospel, properly understood and properly applied, draws men and women together from every tribe, every tongue, people from every corner of the world together. Do you not understand? Every tongue and every tribe and people and nation, whites and blacks and yellows and reds and any other color you want to add on here, doesn't matter. They are all human beings made in the image of God. The sole exclusive basis for the acceptance before God is the sufficiency of Christ's sacrifice on the cross to make one church. One church. Not one church with two levels. Not two churches. One church. One holy blood-bought people. And you are dividing the body of Christ. You are thus insulting the gospel. So while Peter thinks he's acting wisely and truly, even compassionately, caringly, and Barnabas joins them in this stance in order to try to minimize the persecution back in Jerusalem, Paul says, in effect, you can't duck the issues that are theological. Here, these theological issues are so fundamental that you are implicitly denying the truth of the gospel. These truths are so important that if you have to say, if it costs us persecution, then let us be persecuted. So what is the issue over here? Because of pragmatic compassion, Peter is tempted to act in a sinful way. Because of an insufficient grasp of the gospel. He's an apostle. It's stunning, isn't it? It's analogous to the same sins he committed before rebuking Jesus. Undoubtedly, he thought that he was in the right, but he didn't understand the truth. His bad theology led him to criticize Jesus. His bad theology leads him to disown Jesus. And here, over here, his bad theology teaches him implicitly to question the sufficiency of Christ. That's not what he means to do. And to divide the church, which transparently he is doing. Bad theology leads in this way many people to be tempted towards bad conduct. Now, why have I included this temptation in my series over here? Instead of choosing Peter, I could have chosen Jeremiah, talking about the sins emerging from discouragement and self-pity. We could have looked at Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego and considered the sins resulting from the straight demands and towards compromise. Instead, we focus on Peter. Where you are dealing with a man tempted to sin because of inadequate grasp of the scripture. Why? The reason, of course, is because such things happen today too. Our false understanding of scripture can lead us into all kinds of sin. Let me take a couple of examples before we try to articulate a principle over here. Now, over here in some parts of Christendom, I don't know whether if it is true in your area or not, but certainly in some parts of the Christendom, there is a movement called the openness of God theology. The openness of God theology. This theology argues that although God knows everything about the past, he knows everything about the present, he can't know the future, where the future depends on our own free decisions. God is open to the future. He is not really sovereignly, providentially in control. It's not as if even he knows the future perfectly. Mind you, they say he's a very good chess player. He knows how to play the game and respond to the stupid things that we do. But at the end of the day, he is not sovereignly in charge of the future. Now, besides all the biblical texts that this fails to understand, imagine the effect pastorally. You lose a baby. And you go to the pastor and he doesn't say to you that this is a terrible loss and it is so sad that this side of the fall where there will be loss. But we want to have confidence in the living God who still is sovereignly in control. He is trustworthy. He will bring good out of this evil. Nothing happens finally outside the outer bounds of his sovereign sway. And he is trustworthy. Find your confidence in him. We will pray for you and help you. Instead of saying this, the pastor says, well, you have got to understand that God didn't know that was going to happen. You know, it was that he was sort of a sleeper to switch on that one. Now, undoubtedly, he'll give you some help. But you know, I have asked for another baby. Maybe this time, you know, God will be a little more alert when this happens. And now, where's your confidence in God then? In other words, the bad theology affects your pastoral theology. You see? Okay, that's some parts of the Christendom. What about over here in the local Christian congregations? Let me tell you, there is a great deal of health, wealth and prosperity gospel, isn't? Isn't there a lot of claimed healings? And the argument is made to sound very biblical after all. Isn't there a healing in the atonement? Read Isaiah 53 for yourself. Not only does it say that he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of his peace wins our freedom, but also his stripes, through his stripes, we were healed. Healed. The text says so. Jesus was never known to finally turn down anyone who came to him for healing. And Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever, you are a child of the King. Don't you think that the Heavenly Father, the King of Kings, wants what's good for you? Isn't healing a good thing? Therefore, trust. Doesn't Jesus say that if you ask anything in my name, it will be given to you? Name it. Claim it. Just use Jesus' name. Haven't you heard of all those arguments? They all sound very biblical. I can give you a long list of this kind of prosperity gospel preachers. Many who have got churches, many who minister through online ministries, who teach these things. Just name it and claim it theology. They will come up and say, every morning when you wake up, look into the mirror and say, you are beautiful. Oh my God, oh my dear Christian. When you look at the mirror, you ought to say, oh, I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. I'm covered through the righteousness of Jesus Christ by having faith in him. It is Christ's beauty that covers me. But I am a sinner. I am a wretched sinner. That is what we ought to say. That is what we ought to believe in ourselves. They will say, you believe in yourself and you will be able to claim the healing. Oh my God. These preachers can really win hearts of people. They can really attract people. They can even really attract money to themselves. But are they preaching the true gospel? Let me tell you, my dear friends, this is merely the health and wealth prosperity gospel, and the Christians should be aware of it. Should be aware of it. So although there are undoubtedly some charlatans even in this movement who are twisting things in order to their own advantage and trying to make a lot of money, I don't doubt that even in this moment there are some people who honestly think that they are proclaiming the truth. That they really do. That they are like Peter. They think that they understand more than that they do. But there are all kinds of things that they are missing even in their teachings. Is there healing in the atonement? Of course there is healing in the atonement. There is a resurrection body in the atonement. In other words, everything that good that comes to us because of Christ's atonement on the cross, we have the gift of the Spirit through the atonement. We have the communion of saints through the atonement. We have forgiveness of sins through the atonement. We have resurrection existence, the new heaven and the new earth, the home of righteousness through the atonement. But just because it has been secured by the atonement does not mean that we have necessarily any right now to claim it. I have only, in my past years of life, I have not seen anybody wandering in the resurrection bodies yet. Because although the resurrection bodies have been secured in the atonement, we don't get them yet. Although healing has been made secure in atonement, or some might get healed and others might not. The Apostle Paul himself can say, Trophimus I have left behind who is sick. So suddenly what you have here is a glib theology that becomes a little bit like magic. And then what happens pastorally? Your spouse comes down with a wretched cancer. You pray for healing, but she doesn't get healed and she dies. What happens to you then? Then maybe you start thinking about yourself, oh my God, I didn't have enough faith. So maybe you whip yourself because you didn't have enough faith. Or maybe you say that I did have enough faith. I really did believe, but God let me down. Therefore, Christianity is a load of hogwash. Let us just throw away the scriptures. Let us just throw away the Christianity. All this happens because of false theology. At the end of the day, false theology, false teachings has consequences. It has pastoral, moral, and personal consequences. And very often, such false teachings is not entirely false. It may be saying something of a truth, just as Peter says something of a truth when he says Jesus is the Messiah, but he doesn't see that Messiah is also the suffering servant. He doesn't have that balance of wholeness. He doesn't have that balance of truth, of scripture at stake. So what he was saying is Messiahs can't die. Jesus has got to be wrong. So sometimes our more charismatic and enthusiastic brothers and sisters, they sometimes are articulating some truth that there is healing in the atonement. Of course there is, but it doesn't follow that we have the right to claim the resurrection bodies right now, or that even we'll always have the right to be healed right now. Suddenly the false theology is coming home to destroy the faiths and the sanity of the understanding of the true truth of the gospel. Millions of people in our local churches, they have been taught just human-centeredness, but we have lost the sight of God in this. That is the most fundamental things. The most fundamental things of sin and forgiveness and the death and the resurrection of Christ. They are all sloshed over and covered with a veneer of interest in healing and prosperity, all in the name of being biblical. In other words, we ourselves can be in danger of acting badly, sinfully, even blasphemously because of false theology, because of theological errors in our understanding. Now it might be helpful to give you one clear example, and then I will conclude with the principle of what we must do about it. What does the Bible mean when it speaks of the love of God? Well, in fact, when you read the Bible carefully, you discover that the love of God is used at least 5 different ways depending on the context. Sometimes the Bible speaks of the love of the Father for the Son, the love of the Son for the Father. It's a school of theology called as intra-Trinitarian love. That is the love amongst the persons of the Godhead of the Trinity. John 3 says that the Father loves the Son and has given him the Spirit without measure. John 5 says that the Father loves the Son and has insisted that all the honor the Son has, even as they honor the Father. John 14 says that the Son loves the Father and the world must know that the Son loves the Father and that I do all things that He has commanded me to do. John 17 insists that the love between the Father and the Son ultimately becomes the ultimate paradigm of our love for one another. So Bible speaks of this intra-Trinitarian love of God. That's one way that Bible speaks of the love of God. Number two, the Bible speaks sometimes of God's providential love. So Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount says, we are supposed to love our enemies, because God, after all, for His part, sends rain and sunshine upon the just and upon the unjust. He just doesn't look at anyone, any Christian having any farm and says, okay, this Christian will get some extra rain this time. No, He sends His blessings to each and everyone, to the just and to the unjust. In some cases, in the third place, we see that the Bible speaks of God's yearning love. Is inviting love. He says, turn away. Why would you want to die? The Lord has no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Or even in the prophecy of Hosea, we see God presents Himself as an Almighty who is a betrayed husband. How can I give up? I love you. Do you see? God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. That speaks about God's yearning love in the third place. But in the fourth place, sometimes God's love is tied to His election. Jacob have I loved, but Esau I have hated. Or in Deuteronomy 7 and Deuteronomy 10, why has God set His affection on Israel? Because Israel is more intelligent? Or because more numerous or more powerful? No, He sets His affection on Israel because He loves her, and He loves her because He loves her. It's sovereign. And that sense, God is not sending His love on all the people exactly the same way. There is a sovereign election bound up with the counsels of God in the eternity past. And then there are some passages in the fifth place where God's love really, it turns in some way on the obedience of His people. You may read from Decalogue, Exodus chapter 20 verse 6. In verse 5, it says, you shall not bow down to them, serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. To whom does God show His love in this passage? To those who love Him and to those who keep His commandments. And similarly in the New Testament, what does Jude say? Jude 21 say, my children, he says, keep yourself in the love of God. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that God has five different loves. As if he gets up in the morning, says, okay, today will be the love number three. I'll shut down number one, two, four, and five. I'll exercise number three. I'm not saying that. Don't misunderstand me. I'm saying that God is personal. And the way we talk of love in the lives of persons varies from context to context. Do you see, I might say that I love books. I love reading books. At the same time, I might say that I love my wife. But I would probably better not say both at the same time when my wife is in the room. She might think that I am making equal my love for the books and my love for my wife as same. The parents who have grown children may say that they love their children unconditionally. Whether they are good or whether they are bad, their love for them does not change. It is unconditional. But at the same time, even parents' love for their children depends at times on their obedience. For example, when your son or your daughter is turning 18 or 20 and they want to roam around with their friends and they say that I'll be back by midnight. And then when it is already 12:30 or 1 o'clock at night and they knock on the door, if they don't have a valid reason for their lateness, they might face the wrath of dad. It is possible. At the same time over here, it does not mean that the dad has somehow stopped loving their children. But over here, what it means is that the love of dad in this context depends on the obedience of the children. In the same way, God's love for us depends at times on how we follow the commandments of Him, of how we walk in line with the gospel truth. It depends, context to context. Likewise in Jude, keep yourself in the love of God. So the Bible has these different ways, do you see, of speaking of the love of God. They are all on the surface. These five types of love, these five ways in which God expresses His love. They are not denying that one of the ways, God's elective love. Of course, we insist on it. But there are these other ways that you have to integrate into a full-hearted, robust theology of the love of God. So now, let me ask you a question. Christians all around the world have often heard about this, some certain cliches about the love of God. Let me ask you these questions. You may answer it in your hearts or maybe even discuss it with your families. Number one, God loves everyone the same. True or false? You may discuss it, but let me tell you that this sentence depends. It depends on what you are talking about at the time. At the time, there is a sense in which God's providential love is over all humankind, in all of our joint sinfulness. That's true. There is another sense in which this statement is massively false. God says, Jacob have I loved, but Esau I have hated. The second cliche is that God will never love you more than He does now. Tell me, true or false? But you may say, what about the fifth way that the Bible has to speaking about keeping yourselves in the love of God? So God will never love you more than He does now. I want to say, yes, in this context also, it depends. It doesn't depend on God being whimsical. It depends on what you are talking about. It's not as if God is arbitrary. There are many contexts in which that is exactly true, that Christians have been loved before the foundation of the earth. We were loved before the foundation of the earth in Christ. He will never love us more than he does now. He is sovereign. Do you see? And so it does not depend on how I act or anything like that. In that perspective, God's love for me is far more unconditional than any parent's love for their children. But in certain contexts, He can act like a covenant father who says, behave or there are consequences. Keep yourself in the love of God. There is then one more third cliche, that God's love is entirely independent of our actions. Tell me, true or false? Now, you might have already got that the answer is, it depends. You see, in certain contexts, it's exactly right to say that God's love for me from before the foundation of the earth didn't depend on my choosing Him. He has chosen me in Christ before I did anything. Of course, it's completely independent of my actions. And moreover, Christ has paid for all my sins. Past, present and future. That is true. That is entirely correct.
and it should be preached and taught, and that's exactly right. It is independent of my actions. That's why it's never my actions that commend me finally to God and get me into heaven on the last day. Yet the Lord extends His love according to Exodus. In the book of Exodus we see that those who love me and keep my commandments. Exodus chapter 20 verse 6. In the love of God, within the covenant family, there are consequences. When you act in a way, there are certain consequences. Do you see, when we first become Christians, either because we have heard about the Christians, about Christianity in our churches, or maybe during our college times, we don't have too much of the whole grasp of the truth at that time. But when we grow in our Christian life, we grow in our faith as well. When we first become Christians, we do not know too much. And we have some wonderful truths that we cherish. The gospel has saved us. It has redeemed us of. It has redeemed us. We love Jesus. Jesus loves us. And we get our basic confessionalism right there. That's good. That's good. But on the other hand, you can also be like Peter at times. With some real truths. With some real serious misunderstandings in your theology. And those errors will sooner or later ultimately distort your faith that is in Christ. All because of false theology, false understanding, false subscription. And the only way to beat that, the only way in God's providence, is to keep studying the scriptures. In other words, when we encourage people to read their Bibles, it's not because that's a magical thing. Maybe some may say, verse a day keeps the devil away. But that's not what it means. But because we want to think God's thoughts after Him, we want our theology to be aligned with the mind of God. That's one of the reasons why there is a big place on expository preachings and teachings of the Word of God in the local church. Because you want to learn to think God's thoughts after, so that with time your theology is enriched and deepened and corrected, and enriched and deepened and corrected. And sometimes those who know a little more like Paul will rebuke someone who knows a little less like Peter, because in point of fact, false theology has consequences. We all may be tempted to say all kinds of things that are stupid, even insulting to Christ. We may also lead people in misunderstanding the gospel. We may also replicate Christ falsely, all because of ill theology, all because of false theology. Only way to escape this temptation is to study the Word of God consistently, to study the Word of God faithfully. I just pray that may God help us to avoid these temptations as well. Shall we all look to the Lord in prayer? Most loving God and gracious Heavenly Father, we want to thank you and praise you for this wonderful time of sharing that you gave us. We praise your name, O Lord, for you have been faithful to us. We want to praise your name, Father, for the written word, your scriptures that you gifted us, and for the incarnate word, Jesus Christ, whom you gifted us for us, for our lives, Father, in order to save us. We want to thank you, Father, for the availability of these scriptures that you have provided for each and every Christians. Thank you, Father, for it is available in multiple millions of languages, Father. We want to thank your name, for you have made available your word in a way that we could understand it in our own vernacular tongues. Father, but at the very same time, because of its availability, many a times we have considered it of less worth. Many a times, Father, we have insulted your scriptures. Many a times, Father, we have misinterpreted your scriptures to get our own personal advantages. Many a times, Father, we have stood in your judgment by speaking ill theology to your people, Father. We want to say that we are truly sorry and repentant in our hearts for this sin, Father. We want to submit our lives unto you. As we live on, Father, as you have put an example of Apostle Peter in front of us, the way you have used him mightily for the extension of your kingdom, for the building of your church. At the same time, Father, you have kept his life as it was for us, in order to be learned
in order so that we may be able to understand the truth in it, Father. We want to thank your name, Father. At this moment, Father, submit our lives unto you. Help us always to avoid these temptations of ill and false theology. Help us always. Give us the spirit of discernment so that we may be able to distinguish between the true, faithful preachers and between the faithful preachers of your word and between the ill theology preachers and the prosperity preachers of your word, Father. We submit our lives unto you. Help us always to have an ear of discernment. Whatever we hear, may we be able to discern it, whether it is proclaiming the truth of the gospel or whether it is compromising the truth of the gospel. Keep us away from hypocrisy, Father. Keep us away from half-truths, Father. Keep us away from ill theology, Father. Help us always to be a faithful servant of yours. Help us always to diligently study your word so that through us may your kingdom come. So that through our preachings, may your Christ, may your Son Jesus Christ be more and more proclaimed into this world, Father. Submit our lives unto you. Use us for the extension of your kingdom. We want to thank you for this whole week that you as a you gave us, Father, as a church, to preach from your word on the temptations of various people from the Bible. As we have learned a lot of things about the nature of sin, about the nature of the sin of idolatry, about the nature of sin of sexual immorality, Father, about the nature of sin of being arrogant, about being proud, about being self-centered. You have taught us from the temptation of Jesus many things in which Jesus himself was tempted in all ways like we are tempted. You have set a role model before us, Father, in the life of Jesus Christ. We want to thank your name. And today, as you have taught us from the temptations of Peter about being away from the temptation of being in the ill theology and false theology, we want to seek only and only your help, Father, your grace, Father, so that through your help and through your grace, may we as Christians be able to keep away from all these temptations, and hence we may not be able to go into these sins that ultimately give an insult to your name. Submit our lives unto you. Use us for the extension of your kingdom and glory. Take care of us, Father. In Jesus' matchless name we pray. Amen. May God bless you all.